Hello everyone, my name is Akshay Palandle and I'll be teaching you economics. In this session, I will be talking about the balance of payments of India. What are the balance of payments? I'll read out the definition for you. Balance of payments is an overall statement of the country's economic transactions with the rest of the world over some period of time. It includes the outflows and the inflows. So what is basically balance of payments? Balance of payments is your imports exports remittances and so on. Okay. This is basically the amount of money that goes out of a country and comes inside the country. Okay. So balance of payment is that. So now I'll come to the basics of balance of payment. Okay. Now how does India gain money? Okay. India basically gains money through exports. Exports of what? Exports of goods, that is exports of primary, secondary and tertiary sector, that is agricultural goods or engineering goods in secondary sector, agricultural goods in primary sector, engineering goods in secondary sector or other manufactured goods in other secondary sector, and tertiary sector includes services. Services are basically the services like the IT sector. India is the largest exporter of IT services in the world. Okay, its major share comes from these services. Okay, export of these services. Okay. Now I'll explain you a concept called as invisibles. What are invisibles? Invisibles basically include services, that is IT services that we export, or maybe teaching services, then medical services, tourism. These are some of the services that we export and earn foreign exchange from. Okay. The second is remittances, that is transfer payments. Remittances, India is one of the leading countries which gets remittances from abroad. The people, Indians who settled abroad send money back to, what are remittances is basically when Indians settled abroad send money back to the people in India, to their families, that is called as remittances. Okay. India gets maximum amount of its remittances from Saudi Arabia and the Gulf countries. It constitutes around 27% of our remittances. Okay, and the third is income. Now what is income? Income is basically Indian companies who invest in companies abroad or who build their manufacturing plants abroad. I'll give you an example of investment abroad. Indian company like Tata has bought Land Rover. So the money or the income that is generated or the profit that is made out of selling Land Rovers across the world comes to India. It is added to our GDP, or the, you can say, the foreign exchange is added to our reserves. So this is income. Companies like OVL, that is ONGC Videsh Limited, they go abroad, they have their base, this thing, oil rigs in Sakhalin Islands, Kuril Islands, or maybe you can say even in Vietnam. The money or the foreign exchange that is generated from these is added to our income. Okay, so these are invisibles. Okay, so when you are talking about services, you just don't talk about only the services. You know, when you are talking about balance of payment, you do not just talk about services. Okay, you do not just talk about the fact that India is exporting services, but there are other ways of earning as well. So all these put together is called as invisibles. Okay, now why am I explaining you know how much this thing is generated is because how much foreign exchange is generated, because balance of payments plays a crucial role in the economy. What happens is Today, India as a country is largely dependent on imports of oil and gold. Okay. Gold, fine enough. Gold is something that is for our personal use. But oil drives our economy. 80% of our oil consumption is imported from abroad, from Saudi Arabia, from Iran and other places in the Gulf. So what happens is we need reserves for that. We need foreign exchange to buy that. And this foreign exchange comes through these services. It comes through invisibles. It comes to export of primary sectors goods like agriculture, mining. It comes through export of secondary sector goods like you can say engineering goods or other manufacturing goods or textiles. It's all part of the secondary sector. So it is very important for a country, a developing country like India, to meet its energy needs. It has to have large amount of resources, large amount of foreign exchange. Okay, so this is really what happened in the 1990s. Okay, what happened in the 1990s was there was a Gulf War because of which the oil prices increased to a large extent. India at that time was not an open economy; it was a closed economy. So what happened basically was, India's foreign exchange started depleting, you know, to meet its oil requirements, to import its oil requirements. So after a certain point, India had just 7 days of forex reserve left. So, you know, that would last. It had just enough forex reserve that it will last it for 7 days to buy oil. After that, India did not have any forex reserve. So at that time, what happened was, India went to the world IMF and accepted its structural adjustment program, SAP. Structural adjustment program. According to this program, the IMF lent money, that is precious forex reserves, to Indian government on certain conditions. Now, what were these conditions? The first condition, first and foremost, was to open up its economy, to let foreign investment come and invest into the country. Second, maybe, was to reduce its import barriers, and certain other aspects were added to it. Okay. So at that time, India was, so that is basically the phase where liberalization came into being. So all I want to tell here is liberalization did not, it happened because, partly because India was, you know, India did not have enough of cash reserves, or India did not have enough of foreign exchange reserves. Okay, so now this is about it. Now, you know, there are three kinds of accounts. Okay, when you talk about foreign exchange. Okay, now first is trade account. Second is current account. And the third is capital account. Okay, now what are these accounts basically? Okay. So what are these accounts? Okay. What is the trade account? Trade account has the imports, exports of India. It deals basically only with the trade of India. You can say the exporting of foreign of heavy machinery or engineering goods or services, and the importing of oil, gold and other edible oil or other things like that. Okay. So the transactions that happen in the import and export of India are in the trade account of India. Okay. Now what is current account? Current account consists of trade account and educational, you know, forex reserve or the money reserve used for education, money used for tourism, money used for remittances, okay. Now why is this important to know what are these things? Okay, I'll go through one by one. Trade account, as I've explained. Education. Now, if a person is going abroad, he needs money. He needs forex reserves. I, as Akshay Palani, am going to the United States of America to study further. I will need dollars. I cannot go there and make payments or anything in rupees. Okay. Then there is tourism. People, Indians are now going abroad more and more to places like Singapore, you know, world over Indians are traveling. Okay. For that as well, you need remit, you need dollars or you need the foreign currency. And then there is remittances. Remittances are basically the money, is the money that is sent by Indians who are working abroad to their families in India. Okay. The government of India earns a lot of foreign exchange through this. So these are the three things, the four things. Okay. And now what are capital accounts? Capital accounts basically are those accounts that are used for investing in abroad or maybe borrowing from abroad. Okay. Now imagine a company, a huge company, an MNC wants to buy, okay, there is an MNC, maybe an automobile manufacturer, it wants to buy some other companies abroad. Okay. So it will need dollars for that. Okay, it will need money for that. Now, if a country is raising loans through external commercial borrowings, that is, it is raising loans from abroad, then it will need, it will get money in dollars, and it will have to repay this money in dollars. Okay, so this is called as capital account. Now, what is happening in India? The current scenario in India is trade account is completely liberalized. Okay, it is completely open. It is completely convertible, you can say. Okay. As in, what is complete convertibility? What happens in trade account is, how much ever you want to import, you can import. How much ever you want to export, you can export. Okay. There is no limitations to the amount of forex reserve that you are using for importing or exporting. You know, there is no, because this is a very small amount, and in the end it does help India. As in, if a company is importing heavy capital machinery, okay, it will help the company to raise its profits. It will help the company to raise its production, which eventually will lead to rise of profits. So in a sense, it is actually helping the country. Okay. So the money that is used to import and export is unlimited. You know, earlier in the earlier times, in the pre-1990 era, there was not full capital account, full trade account convertibility. As in, there used to be quotas of how much one can import. There used to be quotas of how much one could export. Because at that time we had very, you know, small amount of foreign exchange reserves with us. Okay. Now coming on to current account. Okay. Even current account is fully convertible. Why is current account fully convertible? Because it has trade, or obviously because trade, you know, trade apart, even education, tourism and remittances. These things are very, you know, they don't raise that kind of loans. You know, not, however many people might go abroad to study or how many may, or may, you know, people go abroad to for tourism, but it will still not be, you know, a large number. It was, you know, the number of people will be large, but the forex reserve that is spent will still not be that large. Okay. And remittances, obviously why they are fully convertible is because India gets a lot of remittances, and these remittances are a source of our, you know, forex exchange reserves. Okay. But capital account, that is not fully convertible in India. Okay. I want to highlight on why it is not fully convertible. Imagine if capital accounts were fully convertible in India, most of the Indian companies would end up borrowing a lot of money from abroad. Why? Because firstly, the rate of interest that the foreign countries offer is minimum. It is lesser than what, you know, Indian government or Indian banks offer. Okay. So because of that, most of the people would end up borrowing from abroad. As well as that, the money that is used for capital account is huge. Imagine a company like Tata, if it tries to take over giants, it needs a lot of money. It will need in billions of dollars or trillions, billions of dollars, not trillions, of course. So the money that is used up, the money for buying or for merger or for acquisition, not merger, or acquisition or merger, whatever, the money that is used is taken from the government of India. And this drastically affects our forex reserves. Okay? So that is why India does not have full capital account convertibility. Okay? But you know, there are a lot of people who are promoters of full convertibility of capital account, and they state a few examples, you know, advantages of it. Now, what are the advantages of it? Okay. Firstly is you get capital, you can borrow capital at a cheaper rate from abroad. Thus, there will be competition to Indian banks. Okay. Indian banks will face a competition. It will face a challenge that it has to deliver, it has to provide capital at a cheaper rate, as you know, less as possible. The second is, it is much more conducive for foreign investors to invest into a country where the capital account is convertible fully. Okay. What happens is, if a foreign investor is coming to India, he can invest a lump sum amount in the Indian market and can withdraw it whenever he wants. Okay. Then, you know, there is, what else, yeah. Okay, yeah, FII flow, that is foreign institutional investors flow, can increase liquidity and can modernize our financial sector. What will happen if these FIIs find it lucrative to, you know, invest in India? That is a dilemma. They will find it lucrative to invest in India only if Indian capital account is fully converted. And if they are investing in India, it will modernize our financial system. As in what? What will happen basically is, the Indian economy today is dominated, Indian financial sector today is dominated by banks. There is meager hold of bond market or security market or other markets. Okay. So what will happen if the foreign investors will come into India? They will try to introduce newer kinds of financial, you know, tools, like maybe bond market or security market, and because of that, these markets will also grow, and it will not be a monopoly of the banking sector alone. Okay. But you know, those are some of the advantages that people state. Now, India recently, in, you know, since 1997, has been on a path of making our capital account much more convertible. Okay. It's opening up its capital account, it's giving out its forex reserve to our people, to our, you know, companies to invest in abroad or to borrow. It is giving the Indian companies, you know, like say, you know, approvals to borrow from abroad. Okay. So why has this come in? Okay. This actually started in 1997 because of a committee. It's, you know, it was recommended by a committee called as the Tarapur Committee. It was because of the recommendations of this committee that India has started to relax its, you know, capital account convertibility. Now, what are the measures, few measures that the Indian government has taken? I'll just, you know, read it out for you. Okay. Foreign direct investments has been put into automatic route with most of the sectors. Okay. Now, foreign investment, that is FDI, that comes into India, goes through two routes, that is approval routes and automatic route. So the number of sectors that need the approval of the government have reduced drastically. Okay. There are very few sectors like maybe nuclear energy, defense, which require defense also, it, you know, there is FDI as well, 26% at this moment. It does not need anything. So there are a lot of very, you know, come sectors which are of national importance. Only these sectors now need the approval of the government. If you are talking about, you know, things like single brand retail, or maybe, you know, brands coming into India like Reebok, Nike or whatever, these don't need the approval of the government. They can come directly through automatic routes. Okay. Then, you know, it has enabled the Indian, common Indians or the private, you know, private sector of India to borrow from external agencies, or to borrow from external markets. Now, what happens in this is, basically these Indian players or these private sector in India can get loans at a cheaper rate. Okay. They don't have to pay the same rate that they pay in India. You know, there is a huge difference between the interest rate in India and in the United States. In India, it is around 8 to 9% probably, and in the United States, it is almost zero at this moment. Okay, so they are speculating, you know, they are considering to raise it to 2% now. 2% and 9% still is a lot of difference. Okay.